Christians in Iraq continue to be terrorized by the advance of ISIS. Are the U.S. and the international community doing enough to end the slaughter of religious minorities? The chief spokesman of the Chaldean Eparchy of St. Thomas the Apostle in the U.S. is here to discuss. Are there teachable moments we can share with our children from everyday interactions with media and culture? Columnist and author Marybeth Hicks believes there are. She'll tell you how and discuss her new book. And finally, the stars and creators of the new sci-fi thriller, The Giver, share its life-affirming secrets. Academy Award winner Jeff Bridges and Walden Media president Michael FLAHERTY join us. The World Over begins right now.
Now, from Washington, D.C., Raymond Arroyo.
A warm welcome to all of you joining us from the United States and the world over. So much news to share with you. Marybeth Hicks and our special look at The Giver with Jeff Bridges, Michael FLAHERTY, and author Lois Lowry is straight ahead. If you'd like to comment on tonight's show, send us a tweet. I'm at Raymond Arroyo. I'll be live tweeting throughout the show, or you can drop us an email at worldover@EWTN.com. Let's get started. Here's the brief. News from the world over this week. As Islamic State militants continue their advance across much of Iraq's north and west, the United Nations has declared the humanitarian crisis there to be at the highest level. The declaration triggers additional aid for Iraq, described by one UN official as a humanitarian catastrophe. ISIS' lightning advance has driven hundreds of thousands of Iraqis, religious minorities, from their homes since June and prompted the U.S. to launch aid operations and airstrikes. The U.N. will provide increased support for some 400,000 Iraqis, Christians, and others who have fled to the Turkish territories or Kurdish territories. A total of 1.5 million people have been displaced by the Islamist State surge. Thousands of Christians and Yazidis have been executed by the jihadists since June. Meanwhile, the Vatican is changing its tune, calling for international action to stop the Islamic State militants. This past week, Pope Francis sent a letter to UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon, condemning the persecution underway in the country. The Pope asked for swift and decisive action to stop the humanitarian disaster. Unlike Syria last year, where the Pope pleaded against what appeared to be the imminent military intervention by the U.S. and others, the Holy See this time is supporting U.S. intervention in Iraq. Ambassador to the United Nations, Archbishop Silvano Tomasi, said the Vatican supports U.S. airstrikes aimed at halting the advance of ISIS militants. He called for intervention now before it's too late, further acknowledging that military action might be necessary. Meanwhile, inside Iraq, a big political transition is underway. Thursday night, Prime Minister Nouri al-Maliki announced that he is stepping down from his post after 8 years in power. He's supporting his rival, Shiite politician Hadar al-Abadi, who is charged with building a new government. More on Iraq in our next segment. And Pope Francis began his five-day apostolic visit to Korea on Thursday, calling for renewed efforts to forge peace on the war-divided Korean Peninsula. In his first speech, the Pope told South Korea's president and government officials that peace requires forgiveness, cooperation, and mutual respect. He said diplomacy must be encouraged so that listening and dialogue can replace mutual recriminations, fruitless criticisms, and displays of force. For its part, North Korea saluted the papal visit by launching five test-fire missiles into the sea. Also earlier this week, Pyongyang turned down a South Korea invitation that North Korean Catholics attend Mass with Pope Francis. One other geopolitical note, Beijing granted permission for the Holy Father's plane to fly through China on its way to Korea. This is progress in the relations between the communist regime and the Vatican. In 1995, China refused passage to Pope John Paul II's plane on his way to the Philippines. Beijing broke off diplomatic relations with the Holy See in 1951. And be sure to tune in to EWTN for live coverage of Pope Francis in Korea. I'll be anchoring throughout the visit. Go to EWTN.com for times and details. Back in the U.S., Virginia could very soon be the latest state to recognize same-sex marriage. This after the 4th U.S. Circuit Court of Appeals decided on Wednesday to not delay its ruling, striking down the Commonwealth's law defining marriage as the union between one man and one woman. Unless the U.S. Supreme Court issues an emergency stay, as requested by Prince William County, same-sex marriages will begin on August the 20th. Chief Justice John Roberts will consider the request. We'll keep you posted. And the Vatican announced this past week that Pope Francis has reinstated the priestly faculties of Sandinista priest Father Miguel de Escoto Brockman. The Mary Knoll priest was also Nicaragua's foreign minister under the Sandinista government. Pope John Paul II suspended him in 1985 as part of a larger crackdown on the political activities of liberation theology advocates. The leftist Sandinistas had led the violent overthrow of that country's dictator in the late 70s and remained at war with the Contras during the 1980s. Father de Escoto recently wrote to Pope Francis asking to be allowed to celebrate Mass before dying. Father de Escoto has made no public statement or apology for his actions leading to his suspension. Managua's Cardinal Archbishop Leopoldo Brenes was curiously agnostic about the matter. He told a Nicaraguan daily that the reinstatement of Father de Escoto was a Vatican decision. I can hardly comment since I was not here when he was suspended, and I barely know him, the cardinal said. More details are emerging following Robin Williams' tragic suicide this week. In addition to his decade-long battle with depression and substance abuse, the Oscar-winning comedic giant was recently diagnosed with Parkinson's disease. On Thursday, Williams' widow revealed in a statement that his sobriety was in check, but that he was battling depression and anxiety stemming from the Parkinson's diagnosis. Robin Williams was 63. The laughter and joy he brought millions will surely be missed. More about Robin Williams' troubling death later in the show. Also passing away this week, a legendary star of stage and screen that risked being overshadowed by Williams' passing, Lauren Bacall, whose distinctive voice and arresting looks made her a star at 19, died Tuesday at age 89 at a New York City hospital. Betty Bacall, as her friends called her, starred in 30 films, from To Have and Have Not to her co-star with her co-star and later husband Humphrey Bogart, to The Shootist with John Wayne. She also won 2 Tony Awards for her Broadway turns in the musicals Applause and The Woman of the Year. Bacall was also a National Book Award-winning author. I'll never forget what Miss Bacall taught me about book promotion. About 20 years ago, at a Pentagon City Mall bookstore, Bacall entered the store with a small entourage, and she asked the book clerk where her new memoir was located. Sweeping past me, she gathered multiple copies in her arms, and then she proceeded in grand style to replace all the books in the window with her own. "I have a new book, dear," Bacall told the stunned salespeople, flinging all the other books aside. "Readers need to know about it. You too," she said. And with that, she shoved one of her books in my hands, which I asked her to sign. And she did. That's how you sell books. She was a grand dame and the last of a vanishing breed of Hollywood stars. May Lauren Bacall rest in peace. And finally, it was 70 years ago, this August 15th, when another great lady, a vivacious, wounded girl from a broken home in Canton, Ohio, took a step that would change the course of church history and alter the direction of millions of lives. 21-year-old Rita Rizzo joined the Poor Clares of Perpetual Adoration of Cleveland 70 years ago this week. She soon became Sister Mary Angelica. The rest of the story you should know, and if you don't, find the biography. Dear Reverend Mother Angelica, we love you. This solemnity of the Assumption is also the 50th anniversary of Mother's first vocation in Birmingham. Sister Mary Regina is celebrating her 5 decades of religious life on the same day as her founders. We salute Mother Angelica and Sister Regina on this special occasion and wish them both a happy anniversary and many, many more. When we return, we'll talk about the ongoing persecution of Iraqi Christians and religious minorities. Where is the international response? The World Over Live continues in a moment. Jeff Bridges, Marybeth Hicks, and more are straight ahead. Stay right there.
Now, once again, Raymond Arroyo.
Welcome back to the World Over Live. The advance of ISIS in Iraq continued, and so does the purge of Christians and other religious minorities from the region. Chaldean Patriarch Louis Sacco has called for immediate humanitarian aid and, quote, a professional, well-equipped army to halt the genocide in northern Iraq. My next guest is a spokesman for the Eparchy of St. Thomas the Apostle in the U.S. He's here to update us on the dire situation facing the Chaldean community in Iraq and the recent efforts at the U.N. AUDAY ARABO joins us now from New York. AUDAY, thanks for being here.
Hey, thanks for having me, Raymond.
Now, tell me, we've been hearing these reports about Mount Sinjar and the U.S. dropping aid to the Yazidi population there. What of the Chaldean Christians? What is the state? Where are they?
The Chaldean Christians and all Iraqi Christians are remain in a dire situation currently. They've been displaced out of their homes. We had a letter from our patriarch just on Sunday that close to 140,000 have been displaced, most of them living in Erbil and Dahok. And the situation remains dire. I mean, more food is getting there, but not everybody's getting the aid. And so the people on the ground continue to tell us that a number of things, that they need medication, they need water, they need food, they need shelter. You know, winter is around the corner, and it's unfortunate that what ISIS has started, but they haven't been able to finish in terms of a genocide, Mother Nature and the elements, if these people don't have the care and attention that they so drastically need today, may finish.
Hmm. You were at the UN today. You and the bishop have been meeting, the Chaldean bishop in Michigan, has been meeting with UN officials. You met with the deputy secretary today. What do you know?
Well, it was actually historic the last 2 days at the United Nations. We had both Bishop Francis as well as Bishop Sarhad Jumo from the west side, and our mm-hmm. delegation included a number of people from San Diego and Michigan, and they arms to our message. To actually have a meeting with the Deputy Under Secretary Elison was a big moment for us. And after the meeting, they elevated the situation in Iraq to a level 3, which is the highest emergency situation that the UN has. And so they did that to expedite resources and expedite everything they do, because obviously the UN is such a big network. They're known for being slower than some, but they see this as not a full-blown genocide at this point, but they definitely see this as crimes against humanity, war crimes. And we even met with the special representative on the prevention of genocide today as well, and he sees this as he's trying to put the links together, because under the Geneva Convention from 1948, there's certain things they have to do before they declare it. But they said, declare genocide or not, we need to act today to save these people, especially the Iraqi Christians, as well as the Yazidis and other religious minorities.
AUDAY, I want to read something to you. There was an article I saw just today. Episcopal vicar in Iraq, Canon Andrew White, is reporting that these militants have moved into the abandoned churches. That's where they're setting up headquarters. And he reports horrific things. Literally, a member of his flock watching his 5-year-old son hacked in half in front of him. What are you hearing from the Chaldeans on the ground? How dire is this situation? Or are they just, is it a refugee crisis at this point?
It's a very dire situation. I mean, it's all the above. It's, you know, we called it 8 weeks ago when some of us actually went to Washington, D.C. and put the language together for the House Resolution 683 that We were calling this a genocide. This, in our eyes, whether from a technical standpoint or not, the UN declares a genocide or not, it is a genocide. It is crimes against humanity. They're trying to eliminate systematically, you know, the Iraqi Christians, the Syrian Christians, the minority Yazidis, and everybody else. And anybody who doesn't, you know, follow ISIS, even the Muslims that actually support and speak out in favor of the Christians, they've been executed as well. And when they grab you, they don't really give you a choice. If you're lucky, they'll say, you know, you could convert or pay a jazira. Most times, they just kill you. And they, you know, what we've heard about the beheading of children, they're hanging men, they are raping the women. The sex trade is atrocious. It's the worst thing you could ever actually see. And I say that because today we see these pictures because of social media and other things.
Yeah.
No, the genocides of the past, the crimes of the humanity against in the past, we never saw pictures like, you know, these ISIS, you know, devils, because I don't really have another name for them, kicking around six human heads playing soccer. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, heads on spears for the entire world to see in horror. And so if we don't act soon, not just as the United States, but as a world community, we should be ashamed of ourselves.
Okay,
I mean, this is a genocide occurring before our eyes.
I'm sorry to cut you off. We're pressed for time. The president of the United States has authorized targeted airstrikes. Those continue to repel ISIS, particularly in this northern territory. He's also authorized a lot of humanitarian drops. To the president's mind, this is a fait accompli and mission accomplished. He spoke on Thursday. Here's what he had to say about these drops to the mountaintop where so many of these religious minorities were harbored. Watch.
So the bottom line is that the situation on the mountain has greatly improved, and Americans should be very proud of our efforts. Now, the situation remains dire for Iraqis subject to ISIL's terror throughout the country. And this includes minorities like Yazidis and Iraqi Christians. It also includes many Sunnis, Shia, and Kurds. We're going to be working with our international partners to provide humanitarian assistance to those who are suffering in northern Iraq.
Is that enough in your mind, Audey Arabo?
Definitely not. Definitely not. You know, if the UN, as big as it is, calls it a level 3 emergency, I don't understand where the president's coming from. Humanitarian point, the entire world community is stepping up. I mean, the Vatican's donating money, the UK's donating money, the leaders on the situation accepting Iraqi Christians and religious minorities are France and Australia. We actually met with a number of other missions at the UN from Turkey to Belgium, Austria, Germany. You know, more help is going to be coming, and we want a more coordinated effort. But the U.S. is supposed to lead on this issue. The U.S. is the leader of the free world. Everybody looks to the U.S. Even at the U.N., they re-emphasize to us that we like the U.S. to lead. And we hope the U.S. does lead, especially since, you know, it's not maybe a direct cause of what we've done in that country. But without a doubt, nobody could dispute it's an indirect cause.
This has been going on for a long time, though, Audey. I mean, this persecution of the Chaldeans and Iraqi Christians, this was happening very early on when the United States went into Iraq. I've been reporting on this, it seems, for more than a decade now, since we initially went in. Why now do you think there is the reluctance to talk about what's happening to the Christian community there?
I really don't know, but you know, the numbers speak for themselves. In 2003, we had close to 1.4 million Iraqi Christians in Iraq. 8 weeks ago, we had, you know, around 400,000. That number, obviously, with 140 what they call IDPs, internally displaced people, is just, you know, the start. We need to get these people out. We need to get them to a safe haven. I don't understand why the president is doing what he's doing. In a lot of regards, it might be political. I'm not sure. We did meet at the White House a couple weeks ago with a high-level member of his National Security Council. Mm-hmm. We are emailing them every other day with our concerns. And in emails, at least back, they recognize the plight of the Christians. But, you know, we need to see a lot more from the president, and the world needs to see a lot more, because the U.N. and the entire world community sees the U.S. as the leader of the free world, and we need to act like it. We have a moral obligation to these people. You know, the U.N. Secretary General, when he came to power, one of his first speeches, he talked about, we want to be the voice for the voiceless. Well, the U.S. needs to be the voice for the voiceless as well. We can't live in America and enjoy our freedoms and everything we have, and then just turn a blind eye when there's a genocide, whether it's in Iraq and Africa, anywhere around the world. But I'll tell you what I found out today that was very, very heart-wrenching from my standpoint is, you know, the deputy undersecretary said he's never seen this much turmoil and this much need in the world as today. Yet he's very limited in resources. The resources obviously come from member states. Yeah. And so, you know, their hearts and their spirits are with us, but without the U.S., you know, we don't get far. And so I really encourage people to let their congressional officials, whether they're senators or congressmen, know and keep the pressure on the mm-hmm. administration to do what's right by these people.
We only have a few more moments here. Nouri al-Maliki, the prime minister of Iraq, has stepped down. Is that good for the Chaldean and Christian community in Iraq?
We hope so. We definitely hope so. When we met with the White House a couple weeks ago in the Roosevelt Room, they had told us that, you know, they'd like to see a new prime minister to bring in more inclusive government. I'm just worried that it might be too late, you know, because ISIS is on the march. We heard that they broke through a couple areas in Kurdistan. Mm-hmm. We heard, haven't confirmed for sure, that there were a couple bombs dropped in Baghdad yesterday. We hope it's not too late, you know, because I'll tell you, the biggest heart-wrenching piece of this, Raymond, is, you know, the Chaldeans specifically, the Iraqi mm-hmm. Christians. We're the indigenous people of that land. We go back 7,513 years.
Yeah.
And to see us pretty much disappear, according to the numbers, and people that have always said, this is my land, I want to die here, this is my country, this is the dirt that I came from, they're calling us by the hundreds every day saying, get us out, we need to leave.
That's the most
tragic. That's what we were talking to folks in Turkey. Without a doubt, our history, our culture, our language, we speak Aramaic, I mean, all these treasures for the world to see, mm-hmm. and it's literally being erased. And we're just sitting back as the U.S. not doing enough.
No, this is the cradle of Christianity in the Middle East, and therefore a part of our universal heritage that is being decimated every day. And we thank you for what you're doing and for joining us today. You can follow the latest news from the Chaldean community in Iraq and find out how you can help by visiting helpiraq.org. I was very impressed by this. The site is sponsored by the Eparchy of St. Thomas the Apostle. 100% of the relief collected goes to assist the beleaguered Christian population in Iraq, and it's direct aid, church to church. Helpiraq.org. When we return, columnist and author Marybeth Hicks is here to tell us how to engage the culture to instill conscience, character, and faith in your kids. We'll explore her new book, Teachable Moments, when the world over continues. And later, a sneak peek at the fascinating new movie, The Giver, with Jeff Bridges and author LOIS LOWRY. Stay right there.
Now, once again, Raymond Arroyo.
Welcome back to The World Over Live. The media culture today seems fraught with danger, especially for children. But my next guest, columnist, parenting expert Marybeth Hicks, believes there are lessons to be found even amid the dross. Her latest book is Teachable Moments, using everyday encounters with media and culture to instill conscience, character, and faith. Would you welcome back to the program, Marybeth Hicks?
Thank you, Raymond.
Great to see you. Now, you talk in the book about this Generation M, mm-hmm. Generation Media.
Yeah.
Everything is coming at these poor children today. I mean, everything. How do you cope with it? How do you deal with it in the house?
Yeah, it is. Media saturates all aspects of our lives, and you and I, I'm sure, is as guilty as our kids of having that smartphone handy. But what we need to do is remember that we have to have mastery over media, and it needs to not have mastery over us. Mm. And so what that means is that in our homes, we have to establish standards about content and the amount of time we allow for our kids to be using media so that we really are controlling the messages that they're receiving.
Now, you talk about intentional parenting in mm-hmm. the book. What is that?
Okay, so we need to be more intentional. We need to make sure we're thinking about the character that we want our children to develop. Mm-hmm. So many parents are very concerned about educational opportunities mm-hmm. for their kids, or great tennis lessons, or travel,
go
soccer.
Go to camp.
Exactly. So we facilitate all these other ways in which we want our children to be well-developed, yeah. but we don't think that much about their character. And so in the book, I literally literally give a list of character traits that we would want to encourage and instill in our children. And we need to use teachable moments all along the way to talk about and nurture those character traits.
Now, when some of these messages come into the house, and these are messages and issues that, frankly, most parents probably don't want to deal with. Mm-hmm. I mean, this week, we're eating dinner, the meal goes away, you turn the TV on, and it's Robin Williams' suicide from one end of the television spectrum to the other. Now, we'll talk about that specifically in a moment. Mm-hmm. Some parents I know, friends of ours, they simply disengage.
Right.
They turn it all off, or they are simply silent. They let it play out. They let the kids come to their own conclusions. What's the best approach?
Right. I'm not a fan of either of those, actually. I think what we need to do is be fully engaged with our children. If we're going to be part of a media-saturated world, we have to teach our children by our example and through conversation and discussion how to be discerning consumers of media. So we don't, in the same way that you're trying to teach your children to make good choices about nutrition, you also want to talk about what's good and bad in the media. And media itself is morally neutral. I mean, we're here doing Catholic television. It's media can be great, can be useful, can spread the gospel. But it also can really undermine all the things we'd like to teach.
And remaining silent, not saying anything, sends what message to the kids?
Well, you know, if you're not putting something in that void of values, then the media culture will do it for you. And those are not the values we necessarily want our children to learn.
In the book, you talk about moral development being lacking in a lot of teens. Explain that. Why is it lacking, and how do you counteract it, given what's out there?
Well, we know it's lacking because researchers do regular studies, longitudinal studies, about the ethical and moral behavior of teens. And we know that routinely they cheat, lie, steal. And in one study, they even say, we don't know how good the study is because we know that they've lied on at least two questions on the survey. So we don't really know, except that we also know at the same time these teens say they're very proud of their moral and ethical decisions, and they know that having great character is important. So it's a big disconnect, and I think we've detached our children from the consequences of their actions, and we've let them realize that their actions don't mean anything about their character when in fact they do.
How do you get the genie back into the bottle here, though? Mm-hmm. I mean, part of my approach is I just started writing fiction for kids, and I'm launching this big literacy campaign. The idea being fiction humanizes us. It teaches us how to relate with another human being. You put on the skin and the heart and the soul of another person, and you sort of look at the world through their eyes. You learn a lot that way. Mm-hmm. What else can we do besides encouraging literacy for kids?
Yes, but narrative makes such a powerful point, and you're exactly right. And so we need to use narrative, both good and bad, to talk about the values and the virtues that we want our children to develop. So if you're watching a sitcom with your family and an issue comes up, that you can somehow ask a question, what'd you think of the way that character handled that situation? Mm-hmm. Or, you go together to the movies, and that gives you a springboard for learning and discussion, in the same way that a homily might on the way home from Mass.
Yeah. Yeah, so you use those moments to have a family conversation. And as you mentioned in the book, these are moments when you can pass your values onto your kids in a way that doesn't seem preachy. It doesn't seem like you're doing that. It's a more subtle and, I think, long-lasting way to do it.
Yeah, I sometimes have thought that I've given these great maternal treatises, lectures that were, all
soul
sorts of
stirring.
Yeah, exactly, right? But really what I've learned with my four young adult children now is that the things I said in passing were some of the most profound things they took from me. And, the car is a great place to be teaching about morality and character, because those are places where you can have conversations that are quick and, of the moment, but they're really powerful.
Yeah, movies like This Giver that we're going to introduce people to in a moment. It's a great conversation starter, and I think conversation piece for teens and their parents. But we'll get to that later. I want to get into some contemporary things we're dealing with now. Mm-hmm. Land's End, apparently, when you buy something from Land's End, they immediately send you free subscriptions to magazines so you can try them out. Well, this week, a GQ landed in many a mailbox, and mothers are irate because on the cover, I won't show it to you, is a model wearing nothing but a lei, and you can see just about everything.
Right.
Your reaction to this, what would you do if your 13-year-old walks in with this from the mailbox, oohing and aahing? What's the teachable moment here, Mom?
Well, I would look at it and say, I am so disappointed that Land's End thought this would be something for our family. I would just confront it straight on, as I've done in the past with things like Abercrombie ads and those kinds of places, where you have to just say, you know, this really offends my sensibilities. It objectifies a person instead of, you know, looking at the... And I can't figure out why a men's fashion magazine would have, you know, a man on the cover who wasn't wearing fashion, you know? And so I just would speak to it, and then we'd all watch Mom throw it away.
Yeah. So. Mom shred it on the way out. This week, the Robin Williams story so dominated the media. There was a tweet that the Academy sent out, the Academy of Motion Picture Sciences. I'll put it on the screen for you. And it is Robin Williams' definitive role as the genie in Aladdin. And beneath it said, "Genie, now you're free."
Yeah.
Your concerns about this?
Yeah, because, you know, it is a beautiful thought. They want to have a beautiful thought there, and it was one of his most masterful performances, ironically, as a voiceover.
Yeah.
However, it is a dangerous message to send to vulnerable people who are suffering with mental illness and having suicidal thoughts, because it does, in some sense, glorify suicide and make it sound like an attractive option. And you know, those of us, my family's been through supporting another family through the suicide of their son, and there's nothing attractive about it. And it is grief, you know, that can't be described. And so I think it's really important that we don't. But celebrity culture does this, doesn't it, Raymond? They they get us. They speak about things in a way that is just almost flippant. They're trying to be profound, and in the process, they say something that can be really mistaken.
Yeah, no, they're glorifying something that is not a choice.
Right.
Suicide should not be held up as one of the random choices you can make in life.
Exactly.
It isn't.
Exactly.
It's always a tragedy and a disaster, and people need help. What I love about it is I think it's raising everybody's consciousness about mental illness, which is something, providentially, last week we ran an interview I did with Rick Warren and Bishop Kevin Vann, who are together trying to raise awareness in the churches, evangelical and Catholic churches, that mental illness is something that needn't be shameful. People should talk about like any other illness and get help for. Yeah. That's good and healthy.
Absolutely.
So one hopes that's the takeaway here with the Robin Williams story. Tell me about Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat. This is where our teens are living now. What should be the approach? What would you recommend to parents who are just sort of wading into this social network world?
I think it's kind of funny. I know one mom who will not let her son get Facebook because she thinks it's dangerous and kind of a problem, but she's no idea he already has Instagram and Twitter and Snapchat and Vine. And, you know, so I think parents need to, first of all, know the platforms. You can't really supervise your child or instruct him or teach him how to use these things appropriately if you don't even know what they are. And so it really behooves all of us who have children to be part of the conversation with our kids. So, like you, I know I'm out there on all these platforms, and I follow my kids, and they follow me. Yeah. And that's the only way you can really be involved.
Should you be a password holder with your children?
Absolutely. And if your children misuse their social media privilege, we have in our house what's called Amish lockdown.
Amish lockdown.
Yeah, I change the passwords, and then my teenager can't get to it. And she'll probably see this and laugh because she knows it's been done.
Oh,
and
I thought she had to ride a buggy to school.
No,
or something.
You know, it feels that way when you have no social media and you're 17.
Right. Is there too much technology in our lives? I mean, I was at a restaurant, where was I? In California a few weeks ago. There's a family, they're all sitting around, there are three children at the table. All three children have independent iPads, and they're watching programming throughout the entire meal.
Yeah, it's heartbreaking. That really makes me sad. Yes, there is too much, and that's a perfect example of how we don't even know how to sit still and quietly put the electronics away and focus on being a family, focus on conversing together. And so I do think that parents, again, it's so hard to be the ones who have to always have that self-control ourselves. That's a perfect example of a time when parents have to lead by example. And we can't be pulling our phones out and then telling our kids that it's not okay.
I also think it's such a missed opportunity. This is the one time in the day you have your kids undivided.
Right.
This is when you give them your values, your ideas. They can hear your voice. I mean, for good or ill, when my children talk, and I hear them talking to their friends, there are times where they're using phrases that my wife and I have mentioned through time. They're picking that up through exposure. This is your one opportunity to really leave your mark on your children. Why give that to the iPad?
Exactly. And in fact, research is just definitive that the mealtimes together as a family remain one of the most important ways in which we communicate and pass on our value system to our children.
You decry in the book the loss of or the diminishment of religious practice in America, where some parents say, you know, look, you got to let them have their own choices. I don't want to impose my religious values on them. You think that's a bad idea?
I think one of our obligations as parents is to bring our children into a relationship with God, however we understand that to be, mm-hmm. because that's part of that responsibility of that vocation of parenthood. Mm-hmm. So if we think of it as a job and as kind of a task at hand, maybe we wouldn't see it that way. But I think especially as Catholic parents, we know and understand that parenting is a vocation, a way in which we serve God by serving these children.
No, it's critical. And as you mentioned in the book, without a moral foundation, you can't hold the rest of this together. They're not going to make sound judgments and choices in their lives without that religious underpinning.
Right, but the flip side of that is, you know, there was a just research about a week ago that said 75 or 76% of adults, parents in America are pessimistic about our children's future. They don't think our kids will have it as well off as we do. Mm-hmm. And what I believe is that if we don't focus on the moral and character development of our children, that's true, because it's their character that will allow them to be successful no matter what the economic circumstances are. And so we have to really, as a culture, focus much more closely on developing the kind of person that we have in our home and our child, and really focus on that, not on what their skills are or what college they'll get into or any of that, mm-hmm. but really on the quality of their good character.
Let's talk for a moment about something that you actually mentioned this author in the book. And I know I'm going to mispronounce her name, so I won't, but she wrote a book called Free Range Kids. And she allowed her 9-year-old to get into the New York City subway system mm-hmm. and travel from Bloomingdale's to their home. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know about you. I wouldn't put Arnold Schwarzenegger in the subway system alone without some guidance. Why would you unleash a 9-year-old?
Well, her name is Lenore Skenazy, and she's a dear friend of mine. And her free-range kids and free-range website is really a resource, a goldmine for parents.
She's been labeled the worst mom in America.
I know, right? You Google that and you get it. But she's not. She's a great lady and a smart mom. And I'll tell you what it is. Her son grew up in New York City his whole life. Mm-hmm. So at the age of 9... he actually was really comfortable in the subway system. When you and I don't live there, that wouldn't strike us as being
I'm actually comfortable, but I'm weird enough to fit right in. So
exactly.
But the danger's not the same.
She's kind of the one of my heroes in the movement to reestablish for our children opportunities for freedom and responsibility. Mm. And that's really the big thing. We hover over our kids so closely that we don't give them a chance to actually become resourceful, to be responsible, to become independent. And the job of parenting is to make ourselves unnecessary. And yet, so many parents, even into their children's young adulthood, are hovering over our kids and trying to help them make decisions that they need to learn to make on their own. Mm-hmm. So the point is, you know, not everybody would feel comfortable sending your kid on public transportation, and you know, and that might be an extreme example. But it's not extreme to say, you know, our kids need to learn to walk themselves to school or to a park or to a neighbor's house to play, or, you know, as they get older, to go on adventures with their friends. Or I let my child fly by herself at 14 to see her sister here in Washington, D.C. Yeah. So these are important things that they need to do, but they can't do them if we don't give them that opportunity to
break out. No, they need a little freedom. You have to give them a little constructive, sort of constructed freedom, which I think works to the benefit.
Exactly.
But I don't know about the 9-year-old in the subway. I'm going to stop it
there. Fair point.
Marybeth Hicks, thank you so much
Thanks
for being here. Teachable Moments, using everyday encounters with media and culture to instill conscience, character, and faith, is available at bookstores everywhere and online. You can also follow all things Marybeth Hicks at marybethhicks.com. When we return, a look at the new film from Walden Media, the classic book The Giver, finally comes to the big screen with all the themes and characters that made it a classic. My conversations with Jeff Bridges, LOIS LOWRY, and Michael FLAHERTY, and another little treat are straight ahead. Stay right there.
Now, once again, Raymond Arroyo.
Welcome back to The World Over. The long-awaited film adaptation of LOIS LOWRY's classic dystopian novel, The Giver, is finally hitting theaters, and it only took 18 years. But for the filmmaking team, it has been an endurance test of love. Set in a futuristic, colorless society where citizens are medicated out of their passions in the name of sameness, a boy receives a special calling. Young Jonah is to be the receiver of memories for a society that has none. He begins training with The Giver, the living repository of memory, played by Academy Award winner Jeff Bridges. It was Bridges, incidentally, who incubated this project for nearly two decades. And what a project it is. It boldly deals with themes of government control and euthanasia that will have teens and not a few adults talking.
From great suffering came a solution. Communities.
Injected.
Serene, beautiful places where disorder became harmony.
Do you know how to fly those?
Absolutely.
Do you get to fly to the edge?
Oh, yeah.
What's past there?
Don't know. We're not allowed to fly past that.
Let's go.
It's against the rules, Jonas.
They're called books.
Hello. My name...
I know who you are.
Who are you?
The Giver. When the elders need guidance, I provide wisdom using memories of the past. Our world was different. There was more.
More?
Much more.
Right.
You'll see them all in time, all colors, all differences. Our people chose to do away with emotions. Those morning injections, take them away.
When people have the freedom to choose, they choose wrong.
Tomorrow morning, skip your injection. I've been doing it for months.
Bring up Jonas's activity.
He's inquisitive.
You should know better than anyone.
The way things look and the way things are very different. Watch.
That's my father.
There is no way for me to prepare you for the truth.
He killed him.
The young and the old are killed.
For the good of all of us.
There are things you don't know.
You're scaring me.
Go back to your family unit.
It isn't my family, and neither is yours.
Jonas has become dangerous.
I know that there's something more, something that has been stolen.
Comfortable?
Jonas.
There has to be a way to show them.
You can stop this. You can change things.
Here is my conversation with author of The Giver, LOIS LOWRY, producer and founder of Walden Media, Michael FLAHERTY, and The Giver himself, Jeff Bridges. I know what you loved about this project initially was you saw this as something for your great father, the legendary Lloyd Bridges.
Yes.
What kept you going after for all this time, 18 years, Jeff? What was the theme? What was it that drew you to this work?
Well, the first thing that comes to mind when you say that are my partners, Neil Koningsberg and Nikki Silver, mm-hmm. who were with me all the way through this, and we had lost the rights, we got them back. So having that camaraderie, somebody on the journey with me helped tremendously. And also the themes that the movie and the book are about, you know, this idea of kind of being addicted to comfort, you know. Mm-hmm. We all love to be comfortable, and the movie asks the questions, you know, what are you willing to pay for that comfort? What does comfort cost?
Mm-hmm. Are you concerned? And working on this film, were you concerned that we are reaching a point as a society where to construct a false equality, we're willing to give up rights or even dearly held beliefs and ideas?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's you know, one of the themes that is discussed in the film. One of the things I like about the movie and the book is that it's not really forcing messages down mm-hmm. the audience's throat, but it's you know, provocative, and it hopefully will have people asking these questions after they see the movie. Yeah. You know, what am I willing to do just to be comfortable, and what is that costing me? You know, and is there any value to the suffering that life has for all of us?
Jeff, where did you find this character? He's disoriented. He's weary. Mm-hmm. I have to tell you, you surprised me in the choices you made for this role after reading the book. Where did he come from? Did you base him on something, someone you saw and encountered?
Well, my father, I know, as you pointed out, I really originally wanted to direct my father in the film. Mm-hmm. And I find that my father is with me on many of my performances, that he's mm-hmm. part of it. And a lot of
particularly this character, but I think there are elements to all the characters I play. There's a bit of opening yourself to kind of be inhabited by this spirit, you know, almost to be possessed or whatever, you know, to invite this guy in. And that was part of it. And then also, you know, you're working with all of these experts in all these different fields. There's a guy who says, you know, what about this coat? What about these shoes? You know, look here, do you like the way this room is? And all that adds up. It's a cumulative effect, you know.
In my reconnaissance and journalism, digging around, somebody told me, you read this, our Daily Bread devotional each day.
The Daily Word.
Word.
The Daily Word, yeah.
And when you started filming...
Oh, yeah, wasn't that... It was
what
bizarre.
Did you find in that Daily Word that day?
I think the word for the day was giver. Is that that's like
be the giver.
That's like the Twilight Zone. And it mentioned, you know, how important it is for all of us to give and to receive. But the word for the day was giver. Quite remarkable.
Well, you were the giver, I know. Right. Michael Flaherty, president of Walden Media and producer of The Giver. Why did it take so long, Michael, to bring this story to the screen? 10 million copies of this thing had already been sold when it premiered. What happened?
It's the lesson of Hollywood. There's only about 75 of these that are made a year. Hmm. So it's almost like winning the lottery. And look, we're good friends. We talk about all this all the time. It's Ecclesiastes. For everything, there is a season. Hmm. And I kept trying to will this into existence by my own industry and my own initiative. Hmm. And God had other plans.
How long have you been involved in the production of this, really?
Yeah.
The pre-production?
14 years.
Oh, my gosh.
And the providential part of it all is every year we have three different groups of interns. And one of the projects we used to give them was, we want you to read the script, The Giver, and tell us, you know, how you would make it into a movie. What are we doing wrong? We can't get it made. Hmm. One of those interns was a junior at Tufts. Her name was Julie Rappaport. And several years after she graduated, I got a phone call from her, and she said, Mike, you know, I'm in development at Weinstein now, and I could actually help get this made. And she set up a meeting with Dylan Sellers, their president. I spoke to Harvey, and of course, once you speak to Harvey, the next thing you know, you've Meryl Streep, Katie Holmes, Taylor Swift. So once again, God knew what he was up to and his perfect timing.
Was this on your original list of...
It was.
Of things you wanted, projects you wanted to bring to the screen?
Yes. St. Peter's Church in South Boston has a grammar school, St. Peter's.
Yeah.
My wife, Kelly, taught fifth grade there. Yeah. And... That list was amazing. It was Charlotte's Web, Lion, Witch, and the Wardrobe, Holes, Because of Winn-Dixie, Bridge to Terabithia.
There's a line in the film, and it says, have faith that is beyond seeing.
Yes.
Tell me the component that faith plays in this story, in this particular film.
It's central. It's absolutely everything. And that line is one of my favorite scripture verses. It's Hebrews 11:1. The substance of faith is a hope in the unseen. Mm. It's every movie we have. Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. Lucy, you're crazy. There is no Narnia. Mm. Charlotte's Web. Fern, you're crazy. The pigs can't talk. Everything we do is children believing in something and
there
adults
no
telling them that they're crazy.
Mm.
And here, what he realizes is that this was the way this totalitarian regime kept control over people, because they didn't want people to think that there was an authority that was higher than the government, and that there was an actual creator outside of the government, and he had endowed these people with free will.
Yeah, no, there's that powerful line, they haven't eliminated murder, they just called it by a different
name. They brought it home, and they just call it by a different name. Because language, Orwell showed us this, Huxley showed us this, it is one of the greatest weapons in the totalitarian arsenal. Hmm. If you can pervert the language and call something entirely different what it is, the people who practice infanticide are called nurturers in this world. And that's the other thing. And Shakespeare, you know, as a classically trained actor, you know, a rose is a rose is a rose. Hmm. Language is so important, and you can call them nurturers, but they're still killers.
LOIS LOWRY, author of the novel The Giver.
That my vision was to take a young person to perceive the hypocrisy in the world and to try to do something to change it and to forestall a hideous future. And then put myself in the mind of that young boy.
Fiona, we gotta go now. You, me, and Gabe.
Jonas, I can't. What about my family unit, the other new children? I can't leave them.
This is the only way. This is the only way to make everything okay.
I can't go.
When I get there, you'll understand. I'll come back for you.
Brenton Thwaites plays that young boy, Jonas.
What did you think when you came across that moment where he recognizes this? They didn't do away with murder. They just called it by a different name.
I don't know. I think it's, you know, it's uncovering the truth in that moment. Mm-hmm. She, Lois, in a great way, hides the truth, hides what's happening with suggestions of release.
Released elsewhere.
And, you know, in that line, it basically uncovers the truth of this community and how evil they are.
I don't expect you to understand, but you must know that Jonas has become dangerous. He must be stopped. He must not get beyond the triangle of rocks. What do you want me to do?
You know Jonas. I want you to find him.
And then I want you to lose him.
I know this story originated with your own father and his illness and losing those memories and how important memory is. Do you love the way that it's been depicted here and captured?
The memories that are depicted in the film, I think, were beautifully chosen. There's the one moment, which is a montage, I guess you would call it, of memories, which the giver is giving to the boy to give him strength. And it concludes with the young man standing in front of the tank in Tiananmen Square. I remember seeing that on television. I was in Paris at the time and being just, it was very powerful. And to see it in this context was just as powerful once again.
There's a lot of imagery here that I didn't see the first time. I screened it in DC a few weeks ago and just saw it again last night. There's this tree of life that pops up all over the place. It's in the family dwelling. It's outside the window of the giver. There's this apple that the boy presents to Fiona. Why an apple, Lois?
In the original manuscript, it was a ball. They were throwing a ball back and forth, and suddenly he begins to see it change, and he grows to realize that he's seeing color. An editor pointed out to me, why would they be making balls? Why would they have dye or paint in this world of no color? So I said, aha, I have to change it to a natural object. And the thing that, of course, came to mind was an apple.
Hmm. No Adam and Eve intention?
Not in my mind, but certainly a lot of theologians have found it there.
We experience life through our five senses. But what if everything you ever thought, everything you ever knew, was just the surface of what lies beyond?
The Giver opens everywhere August 15th. For older kids and teens, it's a thought-provoking thriller not to be missed. It's one of those films that strikes the heart and speaks to our time. The questions it raises about free will and the preciousness of every human life, regardless of what society says, are worthy of consideration. This is a movie that people will and should be talking about. Academy Award winners Jeff Bridges and Meryl Streep turn in searing performances. The Giver is in theaters everywhere. My family was still talking about it days after the first viewing. Now is a good time to go to the Cineplex. Next week, actor Jim Caviezel stars as the legendary Catholic high school football coach Bob Lattiser in the inspirational football flick When the Game Stands Tall. Lattiser led the De La Salle Spartans to a string of victories unmatched in sports history. And he didn't just teach his players how to block and tackle. He taught them to be men, moral men.
We're not asking you to be perfect on every play. What we're asking of you, and what you should be asking of each other, is to give a perfect effort from snap to whistle.
When I saw When the Game Stands Tall, I thought of a great outline of what high school athletics should be.
This program was founded on certain ideals.
Perfection, commitment, compassion, brotherhood, faith.
This movie combines the best elements of an incredible football program, but more importantly, an incredible mentoring program. You have a lot of great coaches, but you don't have coaches at this level. He's a life teacher.
About 150 wins. How long do you think you can keep the streak alive?
But winning a lot of games is doable. Teaching kids there's more to life. That's hard.
The coach knew how useful he was, and his values were so firmly in place.
You've got to decide what you want to be.
Coach Ladd would always talk about having everybody buy into his systems of team over self. How can I lift the entire group up, and not how can I lift myself up?
That's what our program's about, when you take your place out in the world.
Touchdown, De La Salle!
I would highly recommend everybody to see it. I think it's ideal.
I would recommend this movie to all parents who have kids participating in sports, regardless of what level.
When the game stands tall.
I love something Lattiser says in the movie, and you say it. He's looking for a perfect effort from snap to whistle. Talk to me about that.
He said, Coach Lattiser said, we're not asking you to play a perfect game. That's impossible. What we're asking of you and what you should be asking yourselves is to give a perfect effort on every play from snap to whistle that you can be dependent on. And in life, champions aren't made through a lack of adversity. Champions are made because of the adversity. They have to go through it. It's what you do in that moment where most people would quit, but you will not be defeated on that day.
My complete exclusive interview with Jim Caviezel about his career and When the Game Stands Tall next week on The World Over. Well, that is all the time we have for now. Until next week, the show continues on Facebook and Twitter. Like me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter. The links are at RaymondArroyo.com. Be sure to tune in next week for the exclusive interview with Jim Caviezel and much more. In the meantime, we'll be scouting the world over for all that is seen and unseen. On behalf of the staff and crew of EWTN News, thank you for watching. I'm Raymond Arroyo from Washington, D.C. We'll see you next time. Bye now.